Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
My name is Nate Chamberlain. I am the SharePoint Systems Engineer for Lawrence Memorial Hospital in Lawrence, Kansas. Anybody ever been down to Lawrence? KU area? Yeah, there we go, okay. So I used to work for the University of Kansas as their SharePoint Business Analyst for KU Libraries. And my experience has been largely based in intranets and trying to find ways of getting people to work better together, particularly in this business power user track, which you can see is sponsored by Crow Canyon. So to make sure you're in the right room, this is Building the Internet of the Future. Just finding ways to use SharePoint, but kind of like Todd was talking about the keynote, not just SharePoint, but using tools together to make this collaborative space for your team to get together and work. It is a 101 level, so if you're here to get into scripting in PowerShell, ROM room, if you're here just for ideas, looking for ways to improve your current environment, this is probably the right room for you. So like I said, I work for Lawrence Memorial Hospital. I've got a blog, sharepointlibrarian.com, where a lot of the things I'm going to talk about are documented. If you want to look up step-by-step, some videos on there as well about how to implement different solutions. I focus a lot of my work in the icons you can see up there, so SharePoint, Power BI, SharePoint Designer Workflows, and Microsoft Flow. And then just recently I've started the Lawrence SharePoint User Group, meets on a monthly basis, and again, SharePoint Library and my blog. What I like to do is talk to people about improving processes, looking at how they're currently doing things, and finding ways that we can leverage what we have to improve that. And just to give you an idea of specifically like my server background, I started with an HTML intranet at KU Libraries, which I'm sure other people have worked with, and it's a lot of fun. But then we went from HTML2 Office 365 for our intranet, which was a big change. So that was at KU. Now at the hospital, I came into something I'd never done before on-prem, so 2013, and we're currently in a migration from 2013 to 2016. So I feel like eventually I'm going to hit all the different possibilities of SharePoint, except maybe 2007.
Hopefully.
Right, hopefully. So what's SharePoint? I'll just start there, because I think it's important to answer this question that I get asked all the time. One of my family members in Kansas City once asked, what's SharePoint? Is that like PowerPoint? Nah, you can put PowerPoints in SharePoint. You can do a PowerPoint about SharePoint. But sometimes I just say, yeah, it's like PowerPoint. But some of these things are taken directly from Microsoft's website, so some good phrases to use when you're thinking about how to describe it to people. But the one in the middle I like makes the most sense to me. Productive team sites for every project, team, department, and division. And that's kind of how I sell it to the people I work with, is that every team, every department has a space where they go to collaborate, whether with other departments or within their own. And the tools that we put in there are kind of up to us. So we choose if we want to use Power Apps, we choose if we want to use Flow. And the more we're able to use, the more empowered our users are going to be to get the work done in an efficient way. So I'll talk more on that later. But also like powerful search. That's a huge seller for people. Because I know when we were on the HTML internet that I had at KU Libraries, our search didn't work. You would search something, it would take you to the main ku.edu webpage. Nothing to do with our internet. Couldn't search content. But now, in SharePoint, we're able to search word level on Excel documents, inside of Word documents, inside of PDFs. So even if you don't know how it's titled, you're able to find the content and share that. We'll just keep going here. So I always struggle with this presentation because I have so much I want to talk about, but I only have 60 minutes. So hopefully we can get through it all. And if I don't, again, a lot of this is on my blog, so you can get some of the ideas that I might have to skim through. So recipe for the Internet of the Future. Just to get an idea, how many are on-prem here? Can you raise your hand? Okay. And everybody else, Office 365? Okay, wow. Awesome. I'm jealous of everybody on Office 365. Because there's so many cool tools coming out. Teams looks amazing. We are lucky on-prem that we can use a gateway to use things like Flow and Power Apps. And I have Power BI Report Server, which is somewhat similar, but it has some limitations. But anyway, as a recipe for the Internet of the Future, content and design. It's not enough to have the tools. It's not enough to have the people who know how to use the tools. But also be mindful about the content that we're putting out there, how we manage that, what kind of archiving and retention policies we're doing. And creating a culture of content responsibility. Because if someone just creates something, throws it out there, who then is responsible to make sure that when someone looks at it a year from now, it's still up to date? Are there any kind of reminders? Is there any kind of automation built in there? Is there an approval process? Questions that should be asked, maybe answered by a governance committee. Governance is the next piece. Who has a governance committee already for SharePoint? Okay. Well, so that's something that would be good to get started. It doesn't have to be really formal. It doesn't have to be really big. What you need, I would say, are people who are passionate about discussing it, who identify the problems every day and they're like, this isn't working. Those people who complain or submit any kind of inquiries about it are probably the people who have good ideas about what could happen. So pull in the people who are just enthusiastic and positive about SharePoint, but also the ones who challenge it, because together they're going to give you a really good idea of what needs to be in that governance document and then how to execute that in a fair way. And the governance that I've created is on my blog, if you want to check that out, for an idea of where to start. And I wanted to create something, we just did this recently, that still left room for flexibility, creativity, and innovation. So I didn't want to suffocate any of that, but we also needed some kind of consistency for the user experience. So that's kind of how that one's based. Let's see. So talk a little bit about co-authoring. I'd love to sell that one. You're familiar with it with Google Docs, so sometimes how I'll start that. Maybe I should flip that. I'll be like, we did it first. And then maybe Google Docs did it too. Automation, sharing. So things that our intranets today are offering that before were just static file shares. Okay, and this is a phrase I like. Intranets are shifting. They're not just a system of record anymore. We're not just dumping things out there and instructing people to go and find them. We're starting to work there. We're starting to engage and socialize and share. Our work is being done in the intranet. Okay, any questions so far? All right. Content design. So these are just some principles I like to stick to. Keep it simple, keep it consistent, and have responsibility for that content. These might sound familiar to people on your own intranets. Outdated content, broken links, layout navigation of pages is inconsistent, poor search, no content responsibility, can't access offsite or on all devices, maybe it's not mobile friendly if you're Office 365. It's just a file dump, I hear that a lot. People using their own accounts, Dropbox, Google Drive, instead of OneDrive and SharePoint. And that's a big issue, a big security issue, and working in the hospital, a huge compliance issue. And that shadow IT thing is real. So how do we address that? Again, not suffocating innovation, not restricting possibilities so much that people go to their own devices. So tips, pick one storage solution. Maybe OneDrive turns out to be easier for people to access from home than SharePoint. So maybe encourage people to make OneDrive for Business the new iDrive or the H drive or whatever you have for your common drive. Divide, diversify responsibility. So don't just have one person responsible for maintaining all of SharePoint. Get that governance committee. Get people who know content, people who work with it already, and ask them for their ideas about archiving and retention. Any kind of templates. Your marketing team probably has a good idea about how things should look or what format to use or any kind of policies and procedures to follow. Let's see. Graphics and icons, people are visual. When they go to your intranet, they don't want to see... that one in the upper left? Does that look very enticing? That's what we went into, and there were so many issues with that, not just with it all being text-heavy, but the minimal graphics had no search. A lot of those things were broken. A lot of those links were the word more with an ellipsis, and then you would click that, and then you would click another link, and just get so click deep. So think about visual graphics that might help to guide people to the right areas, and compartmentalizing things without making it too deep to have to click, you know, more than three times or so. Okay, so more tips. Think about naming conventions. So even if you're not a content expert, you can start to get people to think about naming things in a way that makes files easier to find and sort. So this date format is probably something that's familiar to a lot of people. This year, month, day, that's gonna sort really nicely whenever people do ascending and descending for dates, if that's the first or the last part of your file name. If you have consistent files like newsletters, name them all the same. If you have, you know, corporate releases that are going out, keep the names consistent. And you can use workflow to help with that. If you're worried your users just aren't going to follow it and they keep putting weird punctuation in there, set it up so that if they dropped in a certain library, you rename it for them. Well, not you. Your workflow renames it for them. Save yourself some time. Avoid folders. Sometimes you can't. I've run into that before. But try to avoid it. Get into a culture of metadata where you're able to sort and filter, create views based on that. Explore the grouped view. The group view allows you to do two levels. So that kind of gives that user experience where people still have that folder hierarchy. They can see how many are in each group, and they can go down two levels. And then maybe have to get into folders if that's what people, you know, almost require for their business needs. Think about navigation. So on any one page of your intranet, ask yourselves these questions. Can someone identify where they currently are, what they can do on that page, and then where they can go from that page? A good way to do that would be breadcrumbs. So just keep like a little list at the top or something. That should say like home, and then the next page that they clicked on, just to kind of give them an idea in context when they click on a link out of an email, how they could get there next time without that email. Okay, so keep it simple, ways to do that. Make it easy to navigate. Always keep that in mind, like you're creating it, you know where everything is, but someone who's seeing it for the first time, will they be able to just look at that page and kind of feel where the content's gonna be? Do your icons accurately represent the content beneath them? Let's see, click reduction. I like to keep it 3 clicks or below. If it's more than that, I have to start asking myself why. Why does it take so much digging to get to that content? Maybe it doesn't need to be upfront. Maybe it's something that's used once a year. Is it something I'm going to start instructing people to search for instead of clicking to find? Let's see, is mobile a consideration? Is anybody using mobile internet? Okay. Great, how's that going?
Yeah. it takes a lot of redesign to do it purposely. And sometimes you need to, we have a good mobile app as well as a mobile internet. And
just depends.
It can get difficult at times.
Absolutely. Do you guys use a SharePoint app or
no,
custom?
Not really. I mean, it's okay. Mm-hmm. It has some advantages to it, but we actually have a custom app that we developed for our internet, and then we have the responsive design.
Okay.
And it works well, but it's not perfect.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. That's a good description for a lot of intranets. It works well, but it's not perfect. But yeah, think about that. You know, is your company trending in a way that is more mobile? Do your leadership members need a way that they can go into a meeting, pull up their phone, get certain content? And then who is responsible for that redesign? Who keeps it up to date and makes sure that it's compatible with future releases of the iPad? And even like mobile views and SharePoint don't work on all mobile devices. These are things that should be tested thoroughly if you are going towards a mobile direction. Something I ran into, and I've struggled with this and I still struggle with this when I see all these great releases and products coming out, is the latest and greatest or the newest technology. I want to use it right away. But I always have to think, you know, is this fun for me, or is this actually going to be more useful and save someone time? And one of those things is modal dialogues. Such a simple thing, like a pop-up window to fill out a form. It's one click, but they're still in context of where they clicked that to start that form. But at the same time, I realized for some people that wasn't mobile compatible. So sometimes, even though it's an option, it looks really cool, and people can see where they're filling it out in context, it may not be the best option. Same with like collapsible web parts. Sometimes that JavaScript that runs on that isn't going to be the same thing that's going to work well on a mobile device. So basic rule, try to use out-of-the-box functionality as much as you can. Resort to code if you have no other choice would be my safe way to go about that. Iconography, just some ideas that we used at KU here. Try to divide things into big buckets. If you can, hopefully people will be able to look at these and just visually understand where they're going right away. So maybe a directory looks something like that. You can see an image and someone's like, oh yeah, that looks kind of familiar to what I'm looking for. Maybe it's an actual screenshot of the directory and it looks, you know, recognizable. Up here, we see money, we see travel. Hopefully they can just kind of figure that out. And if you hovered over any of those, it would bring up, you know, more as a promoted links, basically. It'd bring up more information about what's behind that link. Okay, I brought a book, Petting Zoo. I like to do that for some of my sessions. So on your way out, feel free to stop by, look at some of those books. A lot of those resources I found really helpful, which will explain some of the post-it notes. But this is a really great book about thinking about not just, you know, usability, but accessibility. thinking about the colors that you're using in your internet, if they're accessible to people who can't see all colors, thinking about people who use screen readers, and is your content on the back end accessible by screen reader, and if you're adhering to different kinds of accessibility rules, basically. But does anybody know what Happy Talk is? I'd never heard of it before this book. I love it, because as soon as I read it, I was like, yeah, I see that all the time. Happy Talk is, welcome to our page. We're so glad you're here. So try to eliminate that. It's just taking up space. It's really nice and it's well-intended, but at the same time, do you need it? And I don't know. Instructions also. Try to make your content as self-explanatory as possible. So if someone's going to fill out a form, do they need to first read three paragraphs about what they're doing? Or as they're filling it out, maybe the fields have descriptive text underneath each, or is there any way you could minimize the amount of text someone has to go through just to get one simple thing done that they probably do, you know, 10 times a week, but do they need those three paragraphs every single time? Let's see, usability testing. Has anybody ever had a vendor come in or done your own kind of usability testing with card sorting or screen navigation? That's pretty useful. So you might just consider that, look it up, card sorting, usability testing, something that I'm really interested in.
What's card sorting?
Card sorting is kind of like a way to think about navigation differently, where you have people sit down with, you could do it in a bunch of different ways, either digitally or physically. The cheap way, I think, is physically. You get people to come in, they have all these index cards, and either you provide the categories that all these cards should fit into, or you let them help create those, and you say, put these in a logical order for you. Like, where do these links fit into? Is it business? Is it communications? Is it collaboration? And then you're getting your users' info on where they would intuitively navigate to, and then you build your navigation around their collective response. So I think that's pretty useful. And the other way to do that is to do tracking. So you would tell someone to sit down at the computer, use your current intranet, and give them instructions like, go find the travel plan. And then you would track every click they did to get there. And then you say, okay, it took, on average, 5 clicks for someone to find it when we intended it only to be 2 or 3 clicks. So something's wrong there, and you can address that issue. But usability testing, there's a lot more than just those two examples about how to do it. But if you just Google it, you'll get some good ideas. You might find a vendor who can affordably do it. Let's see. Importance from upper left to lower right. This is just a heat map that can attract people's general scanning of a page. So the important content, or the place people look first, is usually the upper left part of the page. You want to put the most important stuff there, the things that apply to the most broad audience. And then the least important stuff go down in the lower right. So things you want to hide, things that are deep secrets. So at least you put it out there, but it's hidden. Hopefully you don't have secrets. Content strategy, another book that's over there. I love this one. I wasn't really interested in content strategy, but this book is written in such a way that kind of makes it fun. And it just blows my mind, but it's really great. It separates content into thinking about it in a way that makes sense to me, which is not just written text, but it's people and the content, and they have to work together. So you've got, on the content side, the structure and substance. On the people side, workflow and governance. And the book just does a really good job of kind of walking you through what each of those pieces mean, and then ways that they've actually experienced firsthand, you know, going about that, and how that turned out for them. Okay, so questions from that book that you might get, you know, how is content created? Is it from a template? Do people create it themselves and then send it through an approval process? Does it end up with the marketing team who does the final cleanup? Adherence to company branding. Is it accessible? Can someone Google on your intranet? Can someone search on your intranet and look up the branding guidelines to be able to do it themselves? Or again, is that something that should end up with marketing anyway? Do they need to even worry about color schemes if you're going to have someone else do it in the end anyway? Who owns the content? How long do we keep it? Think about archiving retention. Think about legal issues around archiving and retention. If you work for a university or a hospital, there are certain mandates, just from my own experience, where you might have to keep something indefinitely. You might have to keep something 7 years. So make sure you know the legal things before you start designing archiving retention policies. What's searchable? So in SharePoint, it's really easy to say whether or not you can search a document library. You can also set up item level permissions on different things based on conditions to make sure when people are searching, they're not stumbling into things that they shouldn't be finding. When I first came to LMH, there were things that were being hidden, but only in views. They weren't being hidden by search, they weren't being hidden by permissions. Just people thought because you couldn't see them that they weren't searchable. So make sure that people who are site owners are educated on that, and that even if they're hiding things from views, that they're also making them hidden from search and permission levels. Does anybody have to approve posts when you're thinking about content? You want a consistent experience for the user, so is anybody just able to go in and contribute their own announcements or events? More questions like that. And then how frequently do you update? You could update once a day, or you could update 5 times a day, but your users might get tired. And maybe your people only work 2-hour shifts here, some of your users. And then when they come in the next day, they're 5 messages behind. That's a lot of content. So just kind of think about how frequently people are even using your internet before you answer the question of how often do we post updates. And then templates and consistency of formats. People want to look at a newsletter that is consistent again and again because they get used to that format. Same with your internet. People want to visit where they know the events are up here, the announcements are over here, and then the documents and forms that I need are here. Keep that consistent. Has anybody used XMind? XMind's a free tool. There is a premium version, but I just use the free and it's fine. But this is a great way to explain to your leadership or anybody that you're working with in your team the current structure of the site. It could also just be brainstorming, mapping ideas, talking about priorities. But if you are interested in a governance committee, this is a great way to just, in real time, get everybody on the same page and agreeing on a format. It's as simple as making a bulleted list, where you start with a central word, you hit enter, it creates another word. You hit enter, it creates another level. Or you can create one or a parallel level by hitting tab. So it's type enter or type tab. Super easy to use. Just another example, smaller one there. And my current environment, so I've got 3 site collections. I can make that really easily clear to people. I can print that out, I can post it somewhere so everybody has access to see what our current structure is like. Any questions before we move on to collaboration?
Mm-hmm. So is your intranet just in one site collection, or does that go to individual departments? Then is that a separate site collection where they're doing their collaboration?
So at KU Libraries, we just had 1 site collection, and then we had subsites for departments. But in my current environment, we have 3 site collections. So we've got 1 which is more for the medical staff, 1 for support staff, and then those are all private sites. The one at the top, though, is the shared. So we have kind of 3 components to our internet. Not my decision, not the way I would do it. So if I could go back, I would try to stick to 1 site collection. But that's because we're a smaller organization. That's what I think would work best for us. And it's really just a case-by-case situation.
But is that just for your intranet, or is that also where can you go back one more slide? One more. So like you, so like your HR there, that was 1 piece of your intranet, but is that also then where the HR team does their collaboration and work?
I tried to make it as easy as you could for them, because right now in our current environment at LMH, we've got like an HR organization-wide page where people would go and they'd find forms, but then we also have a separate and a different site collection HR page for the HR team. So they're so disconnected, and if you have to do it that way, maybe at least put a link on this page, the public page, where people can say, hey, I'm part of HR, I could say like HR portal or HR private page, so that they have that seamless experience, because otherwise they have to remember, oh yeah, if I want to go work with my team, I have to go through this whole other process to get there. But if I want to share something with the organization, I have to go to this completely different URL. So I would try to at least make it seamless, even if they're, you know, different. Does that kind of answer it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All
right. They kind of have to be different because of permissions.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're going to do site-level permissions differently for those 2 groups.
Right. And you could also do like content targeting, too. So I know for like what I'm trying to do is shift all those together. What's that?
Audience targeting.
Yeah, audience targeting. Did I say content targeting?
Yeah.
Audience targeting. So you can say, if they're a part of the HR group, like the HR team members group, show them this extra content. So that's where you could be like, hey, don't forget we have this thing. And you kind of have a shared page. But that gets kind of messy, just trying to keep track of all the different web parts that have, you know, audience targeting and those that don't. So, but as long as you're linking well and you're making that navigation more intuitive, I think you'd be okay. Okay, so collaboration, let's see where we're at. So co-authoring, we've heard a little bit about already this morning, version history, online digitized forms, that's been huge for me. Almost every team, every director I talk to has some kind of form that they want to turn into a digital form. So that's job security for me. And then workflows. So the problem with email attachments, I'm sure I don't have to even say this or show this slide, but basically if one person sends a Word document, let's just say it's 1 megabyte out to 4 different people, there are now 5 copies of that file out there. So that's space on your Outlook servers, and it's also just 5 copies of your file. 2 people make an edit, the person over there replies just to the original senders. Now we have many copies of that file, different versions of that file. But the person on the right replies to all. So now we have, again, created 5 copies of this file. And we have, let's see, the original version, the edited version, the edited version. And who knows if these two editors were making similar changes, doing the exact same things and repeating a lot of work, wasting time. So yeah, just talking about size there. So anyway, the point is when you co-author, everybody's accessing the document at the same time. They could be editing, you know, in the same sentence at the same time. Probably not recommended, but it does save time from all this, I just did all that work, but so did Sonia, or something. And we don't have all this space taken up in your email inbox, and we don't have to worry about having the latest version, like if the person on the left remembered to copy me on that revision. So co-authoring in OneNote, that's been really nice for team meetings. You get together, you blow this up on the screen. People can see you taking notes during the meeting, but they can also get on their laptop and take notes with you, or they could add little tags. Did you know in OneNote you can tag a line as an Outlook task? You can create it as a little keyboard shortcut. I don't know what it is by default, but you can tag any one of these bulleted lines and it creates a task in your Outlook. So that's pretty nice just to, you know, keep track of things when you're doing 5 meetings a day that you need to come back to or follow up on. Oh, co-authoring for the documents. So the alternative situation to email attachments here is that they're all just sharing a link. That one link will take every team member to the same version of the document at any time they choose. They don't have to worry about being kept up to date anymore. They don't have to worry about editing at the same time as somebody else and wasting their efforts. Skip through that. They can edit in browser or client. There are a lot of limitations in the browser version where you can use some formatting or it looks a little strange. Headers and footers, if you don't know how to turn those on, disappear. So people have some usability issues with that. So if you don't have the client editing activated for people, you might reconsider just for that usability experience. But I know there are a lot of issues around that too. So that's probably the biggest limitation I hear in being able to co-author and share documents is that browser versus client issue. Oh, and then overwriting files. We've had people who will download the file, save as, and then, so they've created another thing. They're no longer syncing back up, and we're running into the same issue again. Okay, and you can track on track changes. It's not easy to do yet. I hope someday it will be, but if you do download the file that's in SharePoint, turn on track changes and save it back, then changes will continue to be tracked if people want to see, you know, that kind of person-level editing history. Co-authoring works in all of these, OneNote, Word, PowerPoint, Excel, probably other stuff, I don't know yet. And when you are co-authoring, this is kind of what it looks like. So this is in the client version. You've got who's editing on the right and then a flag for each person within the text showing where they're at and what they're doing. So as long as you kind of have an idea where they're working, hopefully you won't run over them. A good example of version history. So at any one time, version history basically allows us to go from any Superman to another Superman. It's really great. You can restore to that version. You can download a copy of that version. It's pretty convenient. And this is how it looks in SharePoint, where it shows you all the metadata fields, so all the columns for that document library. You can see specifically what was changed, if anything. So these empty fields, nothing changed. The ones with something in there is something that did change in the metadata. You're not going to see the document changes, of course, until you click the hyperlink and look at the actual document. And that'll show you the version of it. And OneNote has a little bit different version history, so if you're, OneDrive. But it's very similar. You still just go in, you can see the revision history. You don't see metadata, I don't think. they can still restore any version of a previous file as long as that's turned on. This is a feature that you need to turn on in SharePoint. Okay, so sharing and collaborating. I've been doing training at LMH. I've done 3 sessions. I've been there 3 months. And something I didn't realize was like a hurdle for people getting into SharePoint and off the Common Drive was just something as simple as sharing a file. So something's on there. How do I send that to my team? So I'm designing a new training for them. Because what I've done so far is just kind of the highlights, things you can do in SharePoint. But there's a need for just learning how to collaborate. People who haven't done this before, who have never shared in the cloud or anything, have no similar experiences. So just telling people to copy the URL like it's a website, something that simple. But thinking about those users like that and designing education for them. Only people who have access to the document or this site will be able to access the link. People are worried about security. They're like, okay, if I copy that web URL, if I send it to my aunt, you know, is she going to be able to access that? And you just, you know, it's all permission-based. That's new for people, too. They don't understand that even because they can open it and see it, that nobody else can. So really be descriptive in your education about how permissions work and how sharing works. People can create their own alerts. That's been really nice for people who are directors or someone who wants to see every revision made to a file because it's, you know, their job on the line or something. So they could set their own alerts. You can create workflow alerts for them if they want more detail. The generic alerts are kind of, I don't know, not my favorite thing. But I do like that you can do the, I think it's like the daily summary, the weekly summary. That's pretty nice. If you don't want, you know, immediate updates every time a change is made. Because if you have 20 people working on a file, you don't need 20 more emails in your day. So that's one nice feature. And then on OneNote, you can see sections you haven't seen. Every time you go and visit, it'll be a bold like page name. So if you could just go in once a week, you can see everything you need to catch up on, and you're done. And so it makes it easy just to kind of stay up to date with everything. Online digitized forms, this is what I spend most of my time doing. People are really interested in getting rid of paper forms and talking about approvals. How can I still make sure I get that director's approval and get this process 3 days faster? Online digitized forms is the way to go. I'm just using language that I use that's understandable. The nice thing is we have options. If you have external audiences and you're on-prem like me, Microsoft Forms is super simple. It allows you to reach that outside audience, and then you can use something like Flow to bring those responses into SharePoint on-prem. If you're internal, you don't have to worry about it. Just create a list in SharePoint and use that form. Okay, so we use, let's see, forms for approvals, confirmations. You can even do reminders on things. So if someone submits a form, maybe you remind them in 30 days if they have some kind of follow-up work they need to do. Or if some status isn't changed to completed, you remind somebody that they need to follow up with someone. Like the workflows we can do with forms that we can't necessarily do with paper forms is incredible. Let's see. And just being able to sort by permissions and department too, like someone submits a form in paper, it's gone. It might be in their email sent box if they're a digital hoarder like me. But otherwise, they don't really have access to that paper version. But in SharePoint, they can submit a form and then go back. They can see when they submitted it, what the status of it is. They can download any previous versions, all permissions-based. And when they're looking at their library, they're seeing a completely different view than somebody else who's maybe a director and sees all their direct reports in there. So we don't have to create multiple libraries. We just have one. We use permissions intelligently, and then people see what they're meant to be seeing. Oh, and the last one, reportable. I love Power BI. I use it all the time. So all those forms, then, that are being submitted, you can use the metadata from that and create dynamic reports that people can see. Take out the personal identifiers and just do categories. You know, like tell people the departments that are being responded to or responding to something. Get numbers in there. That's fascinating to see how many requests are coming through for something or where people are traveling in the air. That's pretty neat to show. And nice to share, to let people know that you invest in your staff. So workflows. So why do we do them? If something takes 5 minutes, and we can cut it down to just 4 minutes, but it's something that's being done 5 times a day, just imagine all the time that could be saved. 27 work days, just by cutting 1 minute by something that's done somewhat regularly. It's pretty incredible, so I think it's worth investing a little bit of time digging into Microsoft Flow and digging into SharePoint Designer. Is anybody on Flow yet? All right, cool. that's my next session, so if you want to see some ideas there. Okay, and this is just going to flash through a bunch of connectors. Flow allows us to connect to all these services, so anything from the outside of SharePoint that you think maybe the data could be brought into to make your intranet kind of more informed, or to use that data in Power BI reports, it's incredible and endless. RSS feeds, that's a pretty neat one if you have staff blogs, just to get people engaged. Ask for submissions, say, hey, tell us what your links are. And then you can aggregate all of their blog posts and you can share all your staff blog posts or put an approval step in there to make sure they're appropriate. And then just have this feed where people can see people that they work with, things they're passionate about. When I was at KU Libraries, we had someone who blogged about pottery, someone who blogged about, there was something about mourning the loss of a loved one. Like, that was their way of coping. But we were able to open that up to a broader audience and people got to know her better. So being able to give your employees a voice in a social area of your intranet is pretty incredible, and we do that all with Flow. It makes it so easy. It watches their blogs, lets us know when there's a new one. We can approve or reject it, and adds it to our combined staff feed. So this is outdated. It used to be 176 when I started doing this. Now I think it's 214 different services you can connect to. So you could think about saving any kind of form submission that someone does to OneDrive and get an email. This could be something that someone, an external client, is dropping into your Dropbox, so that you can just automatically have that moved into SharePoint after an approval step, perhaps. You could add a task to your to-do list whenever someone adds a document. So it could be like, go review this document. That could be your Wonder list. It could be your SharePoint task list. It could be Microsoft To-Do if you're using that yet. You can see all tweets with a certain hashtag. So OSBug today, for example, could have a dynamic Power BI report of all the tweets that are happening. We could see that in real time. So any kind of collection, like that harvesting of data, is fascinating to me when you can sort by a hashtag, because we have SPS Omaha, we have OSBug, we have the handle SPS Omaha. And then you can filter that and see which one's being used the most. You can see what the peak times are. Like harvesting data using Flow, doing absolutely nothing but just turning on Flow, we can get really powerful data that helps inform our decisions about what we do in the future. You can approve travel requests, so that's something I did at KU Libraries. Such a complicated process because I had to go through so many different channels based on who was submitting it and where they were going and what the amounts were. And I ended up using a combination of SharePoint Designer and Microsoft Flow. So that may not be uncommon as you get to know the different tools. And then my favorite, converting documents to PDF. This is something people love. They like that when they approve something, it can be converted to PDF and saved back in the library. That's just really great functionality for preserving things. Also just a really nice feature for people who are putting documentation in there and they're worried about it being edited after approval. Projects and communication, so tasks, timelines, reporting. Is that a big need for anybody in this room? Maybe. It is for me. We're actually getting project servers soon, so I'm excited to get that. But even out of the box, SharePoint has so many ways that your project teams can collaborate and work together. So forms, notifications, and approvals. Like I mentioned, forms or Microsoft Forms is formsoffice.com. That allows people from outside SharePoint to submit a form. You use Flow to connect it to your internal environment as if they were inside doing a SharePoint form. You can still set up any workflows just like you would if it's a SharePoint form. You can solve the alerts that you have as if it were a SharePoint form. Let's see. And you can do conditional things just like a SharePoint form. So if it's, you know, a request to attend a certain event, send it to these people. If it's feedback about an event, send it to these other people. Task assigning and tracking, these are just some different views. This is that grouped view I was telling you about. Every list has the capability to kind of give you that folder feeling. It's just a style you can set in the settings where it shows you that top group. So you just say, what do you want to group by? I set priority for these tasks. What do you want the second grouping to be by? I set task status. So I can dig into that, collapse those sections, and still feel like I'm getting that folder experience. Let's see. So on the left there, it's more of a checkbox view where people who are completing this task don't really have much to do except say, okay, I acknowledge that. a simple task list. So they go over there, they check it, we can cross it off and leave it there so we can see what's been done, or we can cross it off and have it taken off the list. We just see the things that we want to see. And that's just basic views. And then this email at the bottom is just an example, super custom, whatever you wanted to say through SharePoint Designer. We're a little bit more limited in flow on the format of emails, depending on the services you have, if you have Outlook 365 or if you just have the HTML. So you might just explore your possibilities there. Different kinds of tasks list. Anybody on Wunderlist? Yeah, awesome. I love Wunderlist. I really want to like Microsoft To-Do. I'm waiting. I'm waiting for the day that it's just almost Wunderlist, but I'm not seeing it yet. Wunderlist is really nice because you can share with your team. I like having shared task lists. Of course, in SharePoint, you can do that, but Wunderlist is an external tool where you can now share with people outside of your company as well. And then again, using Microsoft Flow, we can start thinking about bringing those tasks into SharePoint to make a seamless experience. Okay, so visualizations, these are huge. People want to be able to go look at a dash, see what's going on. So we can use out-of-the-box SharePoint task lists. These just come with any task list. You turn on the timeline. On the left, that's just a calendar at the bottom, color-coded, so different calendar overlays. Up above, this is out-of-the-box SharePoint Gantt chart, just another view. And then on the left, that's Power BI. So you may not have the one on the left in the top there. But it's another Gantt view. And it's just a really nice way for a project team to come together, say, where are we today? Do we need to extend the time on this? And it's all visual. This is something they can then print, screenshot, share with stakeholders and say, this is where we're at. We're going to have to obviously move this out a bit, bump these other projects back. And they can filter these by different groups. Like on the left, these are all servers. That's how they're color-coded. And so if you're only concerned with one server, you can work with the other ones, filter it. See, I just care about the red one. Social elements. So thinking again about moving the intranet from a system of record to a system of engagement, social elements allow us to get that kind of Facebook experience without all the Facebook ads and Farmville games. So on the left, we've got this. I used it as notes and ideas most recently, just for my SharePoint project team. And so I just go here when I'm in the middle of a meeting, and I'll jot down an idea. I hear something, I'll be like, that's what I want. And so I'll write it down. The rest of my team can see that. They're not in the meeting with me, but they can access this on their own time. When they're in a meeting that it's relevant, they can say, oh yeah, Nate has this great idea for that, or something. I can delete those if I change my mind or realize it is silly. And then other people can, I don't know if it's in the news feed, but I think it's in the forum. People can like things like they do on Facebook. People can ask questions and just like a forum, choose the best response. And then if you want to take it one step further, you can activate the community badge feature so people can earn digital badges for participating in this forum. And if they get a best answer marked, they get more points. If they respond, maybe they get 5 points. So it's just kind of based on, you set those criteria. You say they get 5 points for a post at all, they get 10 points if they get a best answer. Maybe they get 20 points for an original post and only 5 for a reply. But just kind of fun, you can get people engaged that way, incentivize that maybe by monthly giveaways or drawings. Let's see. Okay, and then announcements. I feel like announcements are the underutilized component of every department page that we have for some reason, because I'll go through and I'm working with these departments to find new ways to use their pages that I'm kind of walking into. And their events list is empty, and their announcements list is empty. And I'm like, this is the organizational page that people are going to learn about what's going on in your department. And I'll go to their private team site, and I'll see all kinds of information. And that's where they're sharing it, internally. I'm like, if you want people to get this information, put it on the page that everybody can access. So that's a conversation to have, using your announcements for good, using your events for good, and getting people out there. Power BI, does anybody have that right now? Okay, it's a bigger group. I love Power BI, you can try it for free. You can do quite a bit with just the free version. You're a little bit limited in how you can share after a while. But this is something I did for SPS St. Louis, where it's just flow looking for tweets that had the SPS STL hashtag. I also look for phrases. You can do more than one, so I was looking for SharePoint Saturday St. Louis. And it's just harvesting those and putting them in this dashboard view that anybody could access. It was just an open URL. And over time, it would update, I think, 8 times a day. If you're on-prem using a report server, you can update like every minute, every 5 minutes. Depending on your license in the cloud, you could update more than 8 times a day. But then people can filter this, and they can drag this slider, and they can see just a window of time, which is really useful if you think about the open office hours you're holding, when people are visiting the most, or if you are on a university campus, for example, how do you staff over the summer? Look at your gate count and just filter that for the summer period and see how it was last year, or the holidays. You know, are you busy enough to warrant having 6 people on staff over Christmas break? This is a great way to check that out. This is just another one. Power BI, or Microsoft, I think, does the dashboard in a day training. If you can find one near you, I know Kansas City does it like every month. It's a free training. It's a full-day workshop. You go and you create this dashboard, basically. And it's just, like a 140-page book. You just go page after page. But if you've never used Power BI or you're interested in it, do it, because you get hands-on tool experience. Build something like this. You understand what needs to happen to the data. And then you can take that back to your team and say, I think this is something we can use. Or maybe you can't. Like, maybe it's just not something that you need to do right now. But again, that's a free training. Lunch is included, so if nothing else, you get a sandwich. Quick wins and resources. Quick wins, I think, are important for people who are usually opposed to SharePoint, or people who are, you know, stuck to the common drive and are a little bit, I don't know, weary of the cloud or something. So this is a good way just to think about where to prioritize your time. And even if those people who are weary are kind of against it, depending on this assessment, you may find it worthwhile to still work with them. But this is just a tool you can kind of visualize as you work on figuring those out, thinking about where your current capability is with your intranet, the green dot on the left, and how important that is to business, the blue dot on the right. And the bigger the gap is, that's probably the more priority that item should have. All these tools are available to a lot of Office 365 people. I think, yeah, Flow has a free version, Power Apps, I'm pretty sure. Does that sound right? Maybe. Okay. Anyway, a lot of these tools are out there, but how many of them are you using? And I would never use something just for the sake of using it, but I would look at what it has to offer. I'd get to know the tools that are just sitting there to see if you could get any kind of business value out of it, and then incorporate those into your SharePoint environment if possible. This is a directory tool. Stacy Deerstroll from Focal Point Solutions, she's one of our vendors at LMH. She just gave out this code for free. It's a directory that, for us at KU Libraries, use Delve, and we're using something very similar at LMH, since we had her, of course. But it's great, and it just pulls in all their Delve stuff, their photos, their titles, their contact information, but then also all the stuff they put about their hobbies, their interests, their skills, the schools they went to, so you could just search for, what is it, UNO here? You can search for UNO and get everybody who has that on their profile. You can search for Excel and see everybody who listed Excel as a skill or a hobby. So, and the link's in here, and the slides are all gonna be posted on my blog later, so don't have to worry about writing down the links or anything. Intranet homepages are huge. You want people to be able to go there, see where they're going. It should be an inviting space. So these are just some examples. The three down here are ones that I've done. The one up here is SharePoint Maven. I would definitely go visit that blog. There's a ton of different resources on there. I've learned a lot from him. I think his name's Gregory Zelpond. But SharePoint Maven's a blog. But just getting an idea of a homepage that is social, a homepage that is informative, and not too cluttered. Okay, so these are all things I've recently done. If you go to SharePointLibrarian.com, it's like the top 5 posts or so right now. But this is like a today's events kind of thing that replaces those. I wish I would have put a screenshot up there, but there's a today view of the out-of-the-box calendar part that's just really messy, and if you have a lot of events, it just looks cluttered. So this is to replace that. It doesn't include recurring events, so it's a downfall. Hopefully somebody will figure that out. But that's a good thing for us, actually, because we have Jive and Joints as an AquaFit class. It's like every day. So luckily we don't have Jive and Joints on there every day. And other things that are occurring like that on a daily basis don't get in there. But that's why we put the full calendar there as well. Color scheme, a free tool you can get if you want to just build a new color scheme. It's just a file creation, basically, and you can upload that. Make sure it matches your branding. Content search web part, out of the box, looks very much like the top one. You have that gray overlay at the bottom. You can choose how many photos it finds from any particular library. And then you can make some changes to get rid of that overlay, to do a few more things with it. And that's just a basic change. And then there's a post on my blog to make it a little bit better, to make it a little bit more clean. So that I just moved like the rectangles on the left, made this look a little bit more, I don't know, professional. You see more of the image, not covered with text. Weather and menus. These are things that I just recently introduced too. If your work has people who are going out in the field and are curious about weather, maybe that's important to have on your homepage. If it's going to change the way they work or if there's any concerns, it's linked to AccuWeather. They can just click on that, get the full forecast. Otherwise, it shows them their current location, so you don't have to worry about coding any of that. It's based on the user's laptop's location. And then the menu button, this is a fun one. We have a dining services team who just drops a menu in a folder every single week. And this just links to the most recent one. It's pretty simple, but on the front end, it looks great. People think that I'm going in and changing the link. So, all right, so calendar overlays. If you're familiar with using calendar overlays, sometimes the links will look kind of choppy and they're not consistent. Think about that just from a visual perspective. There's a simple script you can do to make them all uniform. Okay, calendar view, so you can see on the left again there, the consistent overlays, and then also think about how you're color coding. There are a number of different ways you could do it. I would ask users for their input and see what they think. For example, on this one, we could color code by building, by how many people could fit in a room, by which floor the room is on. These are all just room reservations. So see what they want to see when they go there, and just at a glance, do they care about the red rooms, the blue rooms? And then here are just some resources I'd recommend checking out. The left bottom, ShareGate, is my very favorite thing. I use it everywhere. It's helped me save so much time just migrating content, doing a lot of test kind of things where I want to put something in my dev environment, migrate it over to another place. And also just copying list items, content from one list to another, combining lists, moving lists from one site to another, especially in my current environment where we have private team sites and they decide they want to put that on the organization-wide site, ShareGate makes it so easy. Stratus Forms, if you don't like the way forms look out of the box in SharePoint, Stratus Forms is basically like an HTML form, completely customizable. Mark Crackley, I think, is the owner of that one. And then also Mark Crackley on the upper left, PayGroup, has a lot of solutions you'll find useful, I think. Just a lot of little tricks like, I think, collapsible web parts, cascading dropdowns, new stuff like that. And I use this at KU Libraries. It's like promoted links, but with vitamins. So you can change the size of the links, you can change the layout, you can put titles between the different rows of links. Up here? This is spjsblog.com. And I'll make sure you guys have the slides too. Yeah. Okay, and that's all I have. I do have a request. If you guys wouldn't mind taking this survey, let me know how I did today, how I can improve this session for future, I guess, renditions of it. Also, SharePointLibrarian.com is where I post all my slides under the About tab. And you can see actually previous versions of this session on there already. So. Thank you very much. Does anybody have any questions? All right, I do have the book Petting Zoo. I'm going to,
A lot of the stuff that you were showing us today is SharePoint based for internet. One of the things we've seen is people trying to actually have their internet not just be in SharePoint, but be in other places as well. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Like an extranet, internet hybrid?
Well, what I mean is like, so one of the things that always drive people mad about the internet is it's the only place I have to go. I don't really do my work there, but it's where I find too many. It's where I see the news, right? But what we've been experimenting with in various ways is taking that information and surfacing it in other applications. So if you've got a person who's working in CRM, you build a pop-up app that has like the corporate news that pops up in CRM occasionally. And so the idea is to take the internet from being a place that I go to being part of everything that I do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great idea. I feel like that's how we've been using Power BI. Like, that's allowed us to take data from inside SharePoint, including like daily safety huddle stats, which touches everybody, but people don't have to go to the internet to see the report for that. And that's brought up in safety meetings. They don't have to go to the internet. They pull up this report. They don't have to see the data entry side of it, but it allows things from within the internet to be displayed and shared off campus or within the organization. But yeah, that's a great idea. That there's got to be more ways we can think to, you know, get the content that people are using from within the internet to other programs, even if it's an embed or some kind of custom solution. Any other questions, thoughts, ideas?
Do you have any experience at all with the hub?
The hub, like hub sites?
Well, where it's, I understand that in Office 365, anyway, that you have your team sites and it can roll content up from those team sites to a hub site.
You know, I haven't been able to play with hub sites, but I'm intrigued. Is anybody else? Yeah, Max has played with hub sites. What do you think?
They're pretty powerful right now. Mm-hmm.
Promising. Everything I hear is really positive, so I think maybe that's the future. Although when I heard Microsoft Teams could be the replacement of the internet, my heart dropped a little, because that was after I had just built my first internet with AU libraries.
Yeah,
I was like, oh no. Any other questions? All right, well, thank you guys for coming.
You talked about Power BI and stuff. Mm-hmm. How have you been sharing the Power BI reports? I know, you know, if you want to share, you need to have premium license. Not everyone is going to have premium license. Do you just embed that on SharePoint page?
If you have Power BI report server, you're able to embed within SharePoint, so that works. But if you have the app service, you can too. It's just if you don't have a license, then you can't do it as easily. You'd have to make it almost public, which is it.
No, if you create a content pack, does that need a premium license, or can you just...
I think it does need, like a pro or something.
Yeah.
RBI Pro, yeah.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, on our report server, we don't get some of those cool features, so I don't get it.
Yeah. We want to use Power BI online.
Mm-hmm.
So, man, we're very much on like 3 or 4 premium licenses when you have regular license.
Right. Yeah, we don't use it just for security.
Okay.
Yeah. I want to.
Yeah.
Do you
want
to have a selfie with it?
Sure. Yeah, of course.
Push back a little bit.
That good?
Better than the last few ones.
All right.
I had another one with this other guy, and it ended up being super blurry.
Oh no! Oh yeah, Todd.
Yeah.
Very cool.
All right,
have a good one.
Books I want to take.
Oh, what's that?
Are these books to take or just...
No, they're just to look at, yeah.
Just get a picture of that.
Yeah, they definitely get... This one's really about accessibility. And these are actually there. Like, this one's all about information. These have, like, forms and different exercises you can do based on them.
This one's going to be based on...
This is actually, none of this is actually SharePoint specific.
Oh, yeah.
But like, I use this one to think about pulling out the internet, and then I use these to think about the content ownership responsibility. And then this one, like, content leadership, just think about the governance team.
SharePoint, does it interface with project management software. Okay. Or do they use it as a
project management? If it's long-term project management, is that say use Project Server or use Microsoft Project to be on cloud or not?
Okay.
Yeah, those are really helping. We're not going to use the external,
Okay.